Now, I'm pleased to turn your attention to our keynote speaker, Gregg Pasquarelli, who will be interviewed today by MRED plus U board member David Martin. Gregg is one of the founding principals of Shop Architects, named Fast Company's most innovative architectural firm in the world. That's very impressive. Since 1996, Shop has forged an unconventional approach to design and boldly challenged some accepted patterns of practice, pushing the limits beyond the architect's traditional role, especially with regard to real estate development. Gregg has led many of Shop's most prominent projects, including Barclays Center Arena in Brooklyn, the South Street Seaport and Master Plan for East River Waterfront Promenade, and the Midtown Center in Washington, D.C., the largest commercial development underway now in the nation's capital. Gregg is a fellow of the National Academy. He sits on the board of directors of the Architectural League of New York. He has served as Saarinen Professor of Architecture at Yale University. He also held teaching positions at Columbia University, University of Virginia, Syracuse University, and the University of Florida. Gregg's commitment as an educator demonstrates his dedication to impacting the field, inviting a new generation of architects to understand how sophisticated design, technological innovation, and business savviness can be productively aligned. We look forward to hearing more from Gregg during the discussion with David Martin, who is very well known to most of you here. David Martin is the president and co-founder of Terra Group, the award-winning Miami-based real estate development firm known for visionary projects and holistic approach to the built environment. David graduated from the University of Florida with a Master's of Business Administration and Law degree with a focus on land use planning. David leads Terra's operations, sales, and marketing initiatives. He oversees all investment and development projects, and somehow he manages to find time for numerous charitable, arts, and cultural organizations and remain actively involved in South Florida's civic and business communities. He specializes in the identification and acquisition of land, along with financing and structuring of joint ventures and investment groups to raise equity. His visionary projects in Coconut Grove, including Park Grove and the Grove at Grand Bay, and involving leading architectural firms such as OMA and BIG, are just a few of his landmark achievements. Now, thank you, David, for leading the conversation today.
Well, thank you so much for having us here today. I'm very honored to be here in front of you and be here with Gregg Pasquarelli. Architecture and design is such an important element of our business. Design really is about enhancing people's lives. And as I heard in the prior panel, a lot of people were talking about how technology is impacting people's decisions, their consumer habits. And in our field, what we need to do is we need to work with architects like Gregg that focus on trying to understand behavioral habits, try to understand trends in living and working, and so that people don't stay at home and only focus on technology, but really want to be outside and really have an experience that's special. So with that, Gregg, if you could give us a little background on Shop Architect, how it was formed, and what the central mission for the firm is.
Sure. Thank you so much, David, and thank you for having me here today. So our practice was formed by five original founding partners that all went to Columbia together. So to the previous panelists who said there's no MIT in New York, yes, you're right, Columbia is in New York. But the five of us all had other careers before we went into architecture. So everything from fine artists to investment bankers to structural engineers. So we all had different backgrounds and then went to architecture as a second career and came together and formed the practice. And this was 20 years ago when it was a very different time in architecture, where there was this actual very strong division between what we call the sort of paper architects, the architects that could come up with sort of beautiful, fantastical, wonderful images, spaces, design. And then there were the sort of service architects that could actually make a building that didn't leak. And these were kind of two different practices at the time. And we felt that that was a terrible thing for architecture, and that we felt from the very beginning we wanted to build. We wanted to understand how to use technology and leverage technology to make more beautiful buildings more cost effective. And we wanted to get very involved. We felt that the best way to get our buildings built would be to sort of invest in understanding the finances, understanding the technology, understanding the politics, understanding the sustainability, understanding the branding and the marketing, and bringing those all in-house under the umbrella of a sort of architectural think tank. And that was how we started the practice. And so we've spun off technology companies out of shop. Equity positions in our projects with our developers. We'll go out and source property and put together deals and then bring in some of our other clients into deals. We've developed a couple of technology firms, as I said, that are now we've raised money for and have spun out of shop. And we also have companies that we've done that have gone bankrupt and that didn't work. And that's all okay, because it's really about experimentation. It's about pushing the modes of the way in which we practice. It's about thinking about real estate and business and politics and sustainability in a holistic way. And all the time trying to make beautiful buildings that get people really excited.
So talk to us a little bit about the types of clients you work with, who they are, what they're thinking about.
Sure. We're not a specialist firm. So, it's very funny. We'll do everything from NBA arenas, to skyscrapers, to mixed-use projects, to retail projects, university buildings, technology buildings. We're doing Uber's new headquarters in San Francisco. We're doing, you see right there on the screen, that's a tower from Michael Stern at JDS at 57th Street. So a 1,430-foot tall tower on top of a landmark building. That's our office. We're doing the South Street Seaport for Howard Hughes Corporation, which is sort of reimagining what that historic district and retail center would be. I thought it was very interesting some of the things we heard about retail earlier, and we are seeing the same things. It's really going much more to a sort of entertainment complex than it is a traditional retail complex. To public parks, and while that JDS tower on 57th Street has 63 extraordinarily expensive and beautiful apartments, we also did about 3,000 units of affordable housing in New York. So I think our karma is about equal at that point. That's the sort of offset, 3,000 to 60. But so we'll take on any challenge and try and use technology to make these sort of beautiful spaces.
Now, traditionally, great architecture and design, everyone always expects is going to cost more. Talk to us about how you balance great design and feasibility of cost.
Sure. So I think there's the Barclays Center. That's one that I think is a perfect example. So in order to make that facade, we started investing in technology in the mid-90s when it came out of our research as professors into CNC technologies, using computers to help us build buildings, not just design them. And we couldn't get any of our clients to sort of take a chance with us to have a computer make the facade of a building. So we actually had to develop a building ourselves where we would become the client so that we could test out these ideas. So it was the first CNC-produced facade was at the Porter House, which we did in 2001 in the Meatpacking District. Where we took this sort of very complex design and were able to use technology to have a robot basically make this 4,000 pieces of zinc, customized zinc, that went together to make this building. And it was the first CNC-produced facade. It was the first rain screen in New York City. But it was only because we were at risk were we able to take on that challenge. And so we've constantly invested in technology. Here's building, this is the American Copper buildings that are just being finished on the east side of Manhattan. Also completely CNC fabricated facade, two bending towers with a bridge that contains the swimming pool going between the two, so you can swim from one skyscraper to the other on the 30th floor. These are the amenity spaces designed by Kay & Co. fantastic young interior design firm in New York. And you can see the copper is now starting to turn green and will eventually turn green like the Statue of Liberty. But again, fully digitally fabricated facade. So by investing all that time and energy into how we could make there was a kind of transparency in the drawings that gave us more and more control over the costs. And it was by using the technology to do that that we were able to kind of to keep the price of the buildings fairly standard, but getting a lot more design out of them.
Right. And so we have an existing built context, and then we have a new context. And a lot of times in our communities, there's this sentiment for, call it anti-development, more density, which more of a whatever programmatic use is going to have an impact on people's lives. And a lot of times that has a negative connotation. Talk to us about how you work within these communities in order to try to develop neighborhoods that are successful long term.
Sure. So we do lead a lot of rezonings in New York. One of the ones that we did was the Domino Sugar Factory project, which is a Two Trees project, which was approved for 2.8 million square feet, mostly of housing, around its five entire blocks on the waterfront in Williamsburg facing Manhattan. And the original design had basically the five streets went to cul-de-sacs, and the buildings actually sat on the park on the water. And it really kind of privatized the waterfront in a way. And what we did was our client came to us and said, tell us why we would be crazy enough to go through a rezoning a second time. And we said, well, we think this is a deeply flawed plan for many, many reasons. And the buildings were shorter and wider and boxier, kind of what I like to call like a loaf of bread massing as opposed to taller and thinner. And what we said was, look, the first thing you need to do is you need to bring a street through the front. You need to make the park feel public. And that does not detract from your value of your real estate at all. Are the buildings on Fifth Avenue, are the apartments less valuable because Fifth Avenue is between you and the park? No, exactly the opposite. And it was really about knitting this neighborhood back into the existing context. And we also removed one of the buildings and put it back and made an urban plaza. So we increased the amount of public space by about 40%, and we increased the height of the buildings by about 50%, and we designed buildings that actually were taller and thinner but had giant holes in them, and ran simulations that showed that the taller, thinner buildings with the sort of holes in them actually allowed more light into the low-rise neighborhood behind. And after the first rezoning was a three-year contentious battle, we got this rezoning done in under 4 months, unanimous support from the community, and we also got an extra 500,000 square feet given to us by the community to do that. So it was really by joining with them, talking about what the effects would be on their daily lives, giving more public space, connecting it into the neighborhood, being aware of how your buildings would affect them, giving the right mixed use programs like additional schools and other things. That was the thing that really got everybody behind the building and made a huge difference.
Great. Lately, we've been hearing a lot of topics about resiliency, sea level rise, climate change, and what architectural or urban planning solutions exist for this. Are you working on any projects that address that?
Yeah, so the American copper buildings that came, the two folding copper buildings, so they're right on the East River. And we started designing those probably within a month of this Sandy that hit New York. And so the first thing we thought of was let's just take, you know, the buildings that got hit the hardest were the ones that had all the infrastructure in the basement, right? The water flooded in and those were the guys that got killed. So we just said, look, let's just move all the infrastructure up to the second floor. And not only that, let's put glass around it and show that all of our equipment is out of the floodplain. And it's right along the FDR Drive, so you've got, you know, 100,000 cars a day driving by, and it's almost an advertisement for resiliency by lifting all the equipment out and sort of highlighting it. And then what we did was we greatly expanded the backup generator system, and we said, look, if you're living in a tower and you lose power, like, what do you need to survive? We said we needed the elevators to run. You basically need your refrigerator to run, and you need one outlet that you can charge your phone in. And if you could have that, you can like make it a week, no problem. So we actually increased the generator enough that every single unit has a backup generator line to the refrigerator, one outlet, and the elevator system. And you've got this special outlet, and then we designed a kind of key box around it. You could put your phone there. And that was the point. We were like, we're lifting everything out. The flood will come someday, but you'll be okay. And that was one of the ways that we attacked it.
So you address new construction. Now, anything on the adaptive reuse side for existing buildings to address resiliency?
It's harder. It's definitely harder with adaptive reuse. I mean, we are constantly trying to put more and more equipment on the roofs. And we're trying to, you know, figure out systems for floodgate protection. But it is harder with the older building stock. We're doing a lot of work for Trinity Real Estate in the Hudson Square neighborhood, and a good portion of that portfolio is in the floodplain. And so it's definitely a challenge.
And so lately we've been reading a lot about wellness in buildings, whether it's lighting or the quality of air, the quality of water. Are you working on anything like that now in your firm?
We are. I mean, with firms like Uber, working with Dan Gilbert in downtown Detroit, and thinking about another very large, just got a 1 million square foot new building in San Francisco for a major tech company. It's something that's very important to them. And the interesting thing is that the data has been hard to verify, mostly. But that design, wellness design in buildings really has a bottom line impact. But the best data that we've seen on this comes out of Bureau Happold engineers, who are a London-based firm but have a New York office. And they did the Genzyme headquarters in Cambridge. And the interesting thing there was that Genzyme was in multiple buildings, and it was the first LEED Platinum building in the United States. So now they have about 15 years of data. And the problem was always comparing who was in the building. Like, a company might have different workers in different buildings, or they might be in different locations. But here, Genzyme had their LEED Platinum building and then multiple other buildings. And there was sort of the same blend of, let's say, education level and income level in all the buildings. And the data is startling. The number of sick days drastically reduces. The amount of productivity drastically increases. The overall quality of life. I mean, it's numbers that are astounding, and they're just hard to pin down because it's very hard to get the real world examples. But it's clear that the leading tech companies today are the ones who understand this and are asking us to really invest in that heavily.
And you've talked a little bit about your buildings. Talk to us a little bit about neighborhoods. Neighborhoods you're working on now, or you already worked on. You know, how do you improve these neighborhoods to be competitive and diverse and successful?
Yeah, it's tricky. Each neighborhood is different, and it has a history, and the history needs to be respected and understood. And you need to connect to it, because to me, the best thing about branding or a building or a neighborhood is the narrative that it gives you. Like, you tell somebody, oh, you've got to go to this neighborhood. It has this, and you begin to tell a story, right? And so what you have to do is help people to tell a story about what your buildings are going to be and how they're going to work and why people are excited to go there. And if you can get that narrative right, then it's pretty easy to sort of, not easy, but it's easier to fill in the design around it. And there are a lot of things that we see that people really want. They're really, it's about a walking environment. It's about a certain distance that they can go in a particular day. It's about how many things and a kind of pacing. Like, they don't want large stores because it gets monotonous. They want to be able to walk and see many different things as they go along the street. There's even a pacing on street lights. Like, people don't mind crossing streets if they don't have to wait too long at the corner. So making a faster rhythm in your signaling actually increases the way that people will go from block to block. It's investing in public space. Amanda Burden, our previous chair of planning in New York, really did a phenomenal job in grabbing back a lot of unused space and making developers invest in that space. But I think it incredibly increased the value of their properties. And so it's those little things that connect to a narrative and that give you a kind of rhythm and sense of comfort, I think that attracts people to buildings and to neighborhoods, and connecting those to the narrative of the history is the right way to go.
There's a lot of, there's a big trend now with trying to develop mixed income projects, mixed income neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. Traditionally, you found the luxury kind of isolated kind of higher end group in one location and the lower income in another location. Talk to us about what that mixing means, and are you working on any projects like that?
Almost every project is mixed income, certainly in New York, but in other cities as well. The most fascinating data that's come out of this is that the warehousing of the poor, which is a terrible expression, but is how it's used, really drives crime rates. And what the studies have found is that by distributing income levels, it actually drives crime rates down. So the Porterhouse, which is in the Meatpacking District, which was a very different neighborhood 20 years ago than it is today, it's right near a NYCHA project that had pretty rough crime statistics. And now West Chelsea is one of the great art centers of the world. There's luxury housing all around it. It's still the same tenants in the NYCHA housing, but the crime rate has dropped tremendously just by having mixed income people together. So there's a lot of social benefit. I think that people should not be afraid of mixed income at all, and that inclusionary housing is really a benefit for everyone, and that it makes for a richer city. And I think that it's possible there should not be what they call the poor door, you know, that one income group goes in one door and another income group goes in another door, that it actually works and is really beneficial to everybody.
And so when we look at the development and construction community, a lot of these innovative ideas sometimes make the execution much more complicated, the schedule more complicated. Talk to us about your process of how you work with your clients to kind of convince them that these ideas make sense and work.
Sometimes you have to be a heck of a cheerleader to get it done. You've got to really sort of say, like, this, you know, it's very funny. I love being both an architect and a developer. I love when I'm in a room of architects, I talk about finance and everything else. I love when I'm in a room with developers, I talk about design. It you know, to me, that's really what's interesting about it. But the real estate tends to sort of do things the same way until one person innovates and does it, and then you guys instantly change, which is amazing, right? So other industries try and feel and touch and figure it out. You guys kind of go, and then bang, you move to the next one. So what we found is that every time we've been able to use technology to improve the cost control or the transparency or the execution or the building or the delivery or the manufacture of our buildings, and we have hard data that shows that it works, everyone kind of jumps right on board. So, for example, when we did the Barclays Center, that facade is 12,000 different shaped panels of Corten steel that was cut by laser cutters, hung in a warehouse that we designed on like a giant dry cleaning rack, and we gathered rainwater and sprayed the panels 15 times a day for wet dry cycles for 4 months to put 10 years of the Corten patina on those panels. And then they were assembled into 921 mega panels, which were exactly the biggest size that we could get on a truck and fit into New York City. And then they were hung on the facade. Well, the only way we were able to do that was we actually wrote our own iPhone app for the client, where you could scan any panel at any point in the process from cutting, weathering, assembly, delivery, and installation, and get the same information. So Bruce Ratner and a guy with a wrench in the field had the same exact information at every time, and they could all get it on their iPhones. And by doing that, we were able to cut about $40 million off the cost of that facade and deliver it on time, which on the day that the Barclays Center opened, I told nobody to lean against a wall because the paint was still wet, but it still was done on time.
And so you talk a lot about innovation and technology. What do you see, what aren't we doing that you think the architecture development and real estate community should be thinking about?
Well, I think there's gonna be a continuation of of the ability of the CNC equipment, computer numerically controlled digital fabrication equipment, to raise the level of design of buildings while controlling costs. And that's just becoming a kind of standard way of thinking about things. And I think that that's a big difference. You know, because the technology like solar panels and geothermal wells and all that stuff is great. But quite frankly, the two biggest things that you can do to really have an impact on sustainability are, one, design everything a little bit smaller and more efficient, and two, design buildings that people love, that they take care of, and they don't renovate every 10 or 20 years. And that impact is 100-fold times whatever putting a solar panel on every house in America would do. And so it's about efficiency, it's about great public space, and it's about making these beautiful buildings. But we don't want to just make buildings by spending money, we want to make buildings by spending money intelligently. And so that's where a lot of investment needs to go. The other thing we're not doing as an industry is the furniture industry. And Kristen and Avaji of K&Co, we were talking about this today, the interior designer I was talking about. You know, the furniture industry is still scaled for 4,000-foot houses in the suburbs. And you've got all these people trying to move into these smaller apartments, which they don't want all this stuff. I mean, that was really interesting how people are turning parking spaces into storage bins because they have too much stuff. The millennials don't want as much stuff, and we need the whole furniture industry has to begin to adapt to scaling furniture back. And if you go and buy a 1930s or 40s or 50s kind of great, not the reproduced ones and not the iconic pieces, but like the sort of other pieces from mid-century modern, and you look at the scale of that sofa, it's beautiful and it's smaller and people were a little bit thinner, but you know, it's something that is lagging behind. And the furniture firms and the lighting firms and all those interiors firms that get this thing first, they're gonna do really, really well. And we have to help them get there.
So we're here in South Florida, and can you walk us through some of the things? I think you did something in the design district, or you're working on something else in downtown.
Yeah, I'm not allowed to say about too much, but we're working on the innovation district downtown. We're working on potentially another building downtown, and for Art Basel Miami, the Design Miami Fair, we were asked to do the pavilion out in front. So I don't know how many of you went to see it, but it was this kind of big flowing, three-dimensionally printed diagrid. So it was the largest three-dimensionally printed object ever made, about 80 feet by about 40 feet. And it turned into sort of canopies, and it had a bar and seating and sandpits. And so it was a really fun project. So many of our projects take 5, 6, 7, 10, 12 years to get done. And this one was, you know, 3 months start to finish. And then it was up, we had a lot of cocktails, and then it was gone. But Craig Robbins is going to put it into Jungle Plaza in the design district. We're just getting the permitting and putting in some of the, so it'll be there for several years. It'll get to see another day.
And talk to us about the process of working in cities outside of your own, right? And how do you learn about the culture, the neighborhoods, the history, and kind of some of the behavioral patterns that may be unique to other cities?
Yeah, I mean, so we're building a large government complex in Botswana, Africa, which was an international competition. It came down to us and Norman Foster. We were lucky to win it, and we've been working on that for 6 years. I think some of the images are there. You know, it meant spending a lot of time there. You spend a lot of time, you meet with people, you work with user groups. We have 5 people now full-time in Africa working. And what we did was we planted trees when we first started the project because we knew we wanted to do the main interior spaces out of wood. So we got the fastest growing sustainable tree and we planted hundreds of the trees and we're actually harvesting them now. We sent a 5-axis mill down to Botswana. And then we went into the university and started teaching classes at the university on how to use all of the CNC technology. So it was really about knowledge transfer, it was about training a next generation, and it was about using materials that we were able to plant and grow and now use inside the building itself. And so that kind of commitment to when we build outside of New York, San Francisco, we're doing things like that, and And in Asia, we've got several projects. That building is being built in Botswana by computers. There it is. So, I mean, to think that, there's the facade going on right now. With a fairly straightforward construction industry, we were able to build a building of this complexity without any problem by making those kinds of investments in the workforce.
And so talk to us about in Africa and Asia, et cetera, why is it that design is let's say, creating more value for your client? What is it that you see psychologically is happening with these residents or the clients that they're trying to attract?
You know, it's about bringing joy to the people who are going to use the buildings. My favorite thing to do when one of our buildings is done is I don't look at the building. It finishes, and I put it to my back, and I watch everyone else's face as they come up and look at it. And that's when you know you've done the right job, because you watch people's eyes open, or they gasp, or they smile, or they gather their family in front of it and take a picture, or they go around and they're exploring, and you watch that excitement, and then you know, and you watch how people adopt it very quickly, and they make it feel like it's their own, and they make it feel like they're proud to be there, they're proud to live in that area, they're proud to live in that city, or live near it, or live in it. And that's really where design, you know, it's delight, it's joy, and where I think it really gives back and creates long-term value. Because when the market goes up and down, when it goes down, people hold on to the things that they love the most.
So, and you just spoke about cycles. So talk to us about how your firm reacts to cycles. Are you working on more public sector projects or private projects right now?
We've definitely made an effort in the last 3 or 4 years to go into more public projects and more institutional projects, assuming, because we had a lot of private development projects. We have 200 architects at SHOP, so we're kind of like the biggest firm in the United States that you never heard of. And it's because we've been around for almost 20 years. We only really have about 10 buildings completed, but we've got 22 under construction around the world right now, and there's another 40 on the boards. So we're in a moment where our office is going to change and who we are and what we do. I think that what we knew was that we had to make sure that we were diversified in as many different sectors as possible.
Right.
And we believe that being a generalist architect is actually the best thing that you can be, because we constantly come at any problem we're given with a fresh set of eyes. So we were completely unqualified to do any building that you've seen go by right now. And I think that that's why we do good buildings, because it's not a formulaic response to everything. And I think that the formulas get really tired very, very quickly, and that you've got to constantly be innovating and testing things out.
And talk to us about these businesses that you mentioned, that these offshoots, some of the, what exactly were they, products, were they services, what are they?
So the one thing that we did was we tried to do a design build company, which we had for a while, which didn't do well, and we let it go for 7 years, and then we had to close it, so that was a failure. At the same time, we did a tech company, so it's a zoning analysis program that'll run on your iPhone, so instead of paying an architect or a good zoning attorney, you know, for 6 hours of work, it will mass your building. It'll prompt you with all your options and mass your building for you in less than 60 seconds. And we also in New York, because we have so many vertical buildings, solar panels are really not something we can do because we only have a small roof to put them on top of. So we have developed in conjunction with Rensselaer Polytech Institute and CASE, run by Anna Dyson and SHOP, have developed a solar panel system that you can see through. That's also a daylighting control system. So it's both your shades. Think of like the coolest jalousie shades you've ever seen inside your facade that you can see through, and it generates power. And so it's a solar panel that you can see through. So now the entire south facade of a skyscraper can be covered in power generating technology. So that's called helioptics. We've spun that out, and that should be commercially available within 14 to 18 months.
Are you seeing a trend in net zero type projects that are trying to be independent of the electrical grid?
Absolutely, absolutely. Many of our clients ask us to get there, especially the tech world, which is really tough to do when every single person has two 42-inch flat screens on their desk writing code. That's a pretty big power draw. But absolutely, people are trying to figure out how to do that as much as possible. And even, I think the other thing is even just not needing the power as much. So for example, helioptics, because it diffuses the light coming through as it's generating power, we're trying to get there. We think that it means that you need about 30% less air conditioning in the main plant to begin with. And so it's even just the good design can actually limit what you need to use in and of itself. It's not only the sustainable bling you have to hang on the building, it's just smart design is actually sustainable in and of itself.
Great, great. So, you know, with that, you know, Gregg, I think we're clear on kind of what you do. Is there anything that you think that in design and architecture that you think is lacking in our society? Is there something that you feel that there's a trend that for instance, you know, we have this trend of people living in smaller spaces. We have a trend of commercial owners wanting packing in their employees in smaller places. We have this anti-suburban kind of grocery anchored or anti-suburban mall type. Is there anything that architecture and design can do to kind of, you know, again, repurpose or improve or change some of these existing assets so they don't become kind of a drain on the tax base or a drain on the beauty of a city?
Well, yeah, unquestionably. So, you know, the other thing is building density next to mass transit is the most important thing you can do. But you also have to, as I said before, invest in public space, invest in the quality of the buildings. Because if you're going to build density around mass transit and build crappy buildings, it's going to be a terrible life for everybody. So, but you can do it. You can live smaller. You can live more efficient. You can, if the design is good, you don't feel like you're living smaller. I'll take a perfect example in our office. So when we moved our offices, and we're in the Woolworth building in Lower Manhattan, and we have a whole floor there. And our old office, which was across the street, we had about 165 square feet per employee. We moved into the new office, and it's a cruciform plan, if you will, and where the altar is, we have 24 hours a day iced coffee taps and 24 hours a day beer taps. And the staff basically moves between caffeine and alcohol all day long. And it's the altar, and it's the gathering place, and it's where everyone comes together. And we really invested in the public space of the office. Fascinatingly, that office is 135 square feet per employee. And every one of the employees comes up and says, I love the new office. It's so much more room. It's so much great space. And this is fantastic. But it was actually, you know, 20% smaller. So it was really just about great design, great public space, great amenities, caffeine and alcohol, and you can really it can really make a difference.
Well, thank you so much. So maybe we could we have a few minutes now to talk. Maybe ask a few questions. So if anyone in the audience has a question, we'd love to hear.
Get a question in. Gregg, I know SHOP is doing some work and one of our themes going through today is disruptive technologies. You heard from the first panel on WeWork. I know SHOP's doing work for Uber, I believe, and
yes,
maybe for Google. Can you talk a little bit about working for those clients and how they envision their workspace?
I'm being filmed, right? Okay, then I know how to answer it. So the, it's, I think it's a lot of what we said. We're also working for, we've worked with Sidewalks Labs, we've worked with Google, we've done a building for Google, we've done master planning, we're doing another, like I said, I can't announce what it is, but a million square foot headquarters for another tech company, and we're working on four buildings for Uber right now. So doing work in the tech industry, I think, is really fun, because I think they're more willing to try things out and innovate than a lot of traditional industries. Working in San Francisco poses its own challenges. I thought it was hard getting things approved in New York. I found a city that's worse. But we have gotten them through, and that Uber headquarters, when it comes up, I'll point it out, that's a breathing facade. So a lot of what Travis wanted to do was sort of show what Uber, everyone thinks of Uber behind the sort of black glass on your iPhone. And he really wanted to sort of make a building where everyone could see everybody kind of working. And so there's almost a vertical park through the facade of the building that all the meeting rooms and all the collaborative spaces occupy the facade, the thickness of the facade itself. And that facade actually opens and closes automatically based on the local weather and is not air-conditioned space at all. So it's literally like a vertical outdoor park going through the front facade of your building. Then there are doors and where the computers are and where they're coding. That needs to be air conditioned for the equipment's purpose. But I think that would be a San Francisco's weather helps, but still a tougher project to do for a law firm or a financial firm. So I think that's kind of one of the things that's interesting. This building that you just saw is the new building we're doing for Michael Stern also in Brooklyn. That'll be the tallest building in Brooklyn. And the first 1,000-foot tower outside of, I think, on the East Coast, outside of Manhattan. But it's actually 1,150 feet. But that's a mixed-use building. And so I think working for the tech industry, it's that openness to innovation that I think makes it really interesting for us.
The great questions that you've posed, David, and for the very informative answers. My name is Elena Blunzer. I'm a real estate broker in the city. And I've always been very curious, how do the architects, and I guess then next function, the developers, collect the information that, as you mentioned, the designs have to be loved? How do you collect the information and decide what designs are loved by people?
It's an excellent question. This is a little I have a great slide for this, but I didn't bring it today. But there's this thing that I call that's the Uber building, by the way, with the park. Sorry, that's the inside place. So there is an inherent structural problem, which is what I call the cycle of mediocrity, which is that whenever we all know this, you go to the bank to underwrite your deal, and all they want to see is the comps. And so when you want to show them the comps, it's like they want to know the five products that were just like this one in this neighborhood, square footage. So there's no way it's really hard to innovate because there's no way to sort of change it. So, what are the comps? The comps are what was available for sale, which is what the brokers had to sell, which generated a marketing report that told people that this is what people, that told the designers and the owners, this is what people like. And, I don't think everyone wants granite countertops. Right, but it's like in every damn project, over and over and over again, because somewhere a banker was like, it needs to check all these boxes, and so that's where that's the most difficult part of the underwriting. I think that the development industry, the real estate industry, the architects want to innovate more, but it's the financial handcuffs that are put on us, and so therefore the data I don't believe, because there was only one choice. And so it's hard to collect the data, but I guess the one thing I would say is just look at how many times people move out. And if people stay in those apartments or whatever they might be and they love it, then that's your hard data right there, that there was something about it that worked.
You mentioned an app that would help you analyze the entitlements of a site. What more can
you tell us about that? Sure, the product is called Envelope. And we're starting in New York just because it's what we know the best, but we've gone through our second round of our venture capital raises. The beta is going to be online. We've got 100 beta users probably within 2 months. And you would be able to call up any site. It will show you the map. It will automatically look for any air rights that are available to transfer. It will start to prompt you with a series of questions, reading the zoning code and the building code. You can just pick what you can do as of right. You can pick your floor-to-floor heights, your mixed use, whatever it might be, and it takes about 60 seconds, and it will mass your building for you. You could spin it around. You could toggle and change things. And then when you like it, instead of hitting print, It sends the 3D model to Revit for your architect to start to draw it, and it sends all your floor plate sizes in Excel so you can start to run your financial models. And so, you know, at a cost of a few dollars each time instead of thousands. And so a lot of people said, aren't there going to be a lot of architects and zoning attorneys that are going to like put out a fatwa on you for that? And I said, no, I didn't think so at all. That in fact, I felt it was going to be very much like when spreadsheets, I guess it was Lotus 1-2-3, first came out, and we could start to look at sensitivity analysis in a much different way, that the mergers and acquisitions market in the 80s boomed. And I actually think that a lot of deals die because of arguments over what the entitlements are and what you can and can't build and what it could look like, especially in New York with the complexity of the zoning code. And so I feel it's going to absolutely increase deal flow and really help the industry as a whole. That's at least our hope for it. And if we make a few bucks on the side, that's great.
So, question.
Sure.
Is on? Yeah. Thank you. First of all, thank you for being here on behalf of the MRED program and the University of Miami School of Architecture. What are some of the challenges on the design build? Because one would think that there'll be efficiencies that would then allow for some of these extra design things. Why doesn't it work?
It's a very good question. I don't know. I don't know if it was a leadership problem. I don't know if it was just a different skill set fundamentally. And so getting architects to become builders was hard for us. And I think that there were a lot of great successes, but at the end of the day, it was not a financial success. But we learned a tremendous amount about it, and so that's fine. And we're comfortable with having failures. It's just part of learning. I can draw a parallel to some of you may or may not know another innovative building that we did that turned out okay, but not what we had hoped, which was the first tower next to the Barclays Center, which was supposed to be the first modularly built skyscraper in the country. And a 32-story tower, all built in a factory in the Brooklyn Navy Yard and then assembled as boxes 32 stories tall. And it was a fascinating project to work on, and one that I really actually believe in the technology in the future, especially for not only affordable housing, also luxury housing, right? I mean, No one says a BMW is not a good car because a robot helped put it together. But the problem was that, and I won't go into all the details, but the way in which the project got built was they had construction people running a factory. And there's a fundamental difference between construction and manufacturing in the way you think about it. And that was the problem. It was the wrong skill set people trying to do something different. So part of innovation is testing things out and trying them, but then it's also bringing in unlikely people to your organization who have that specific skill set to tell you how it's done in that field, and then think about how you can switch your own business practice to make it work. Now, the building should have been built in 14 months, and it ended up taking 4 years, mostly because of lawsuits between the construction, the owner and the contractor. Because the contractor did not understand what manufacturing was. But it looks good, and it's finished, and people are moving in.
Well, Gregg, thank you so much for today. I really appreciate it.